Hello, and welcome to part two of the first of the three weekly lessons about Oracle JET. In the first part, you were introduced to the ideas behind JET. A central problem in JavaScript is related to the absence of modularity, as well as the absence of built-in file loading mechanisms. While the JavaScript ecosystem continues to innovate, with new features and libraries popping up continually, there have for a long time not been any built-in solutions in JavaScript to solve this specific set of problems. That's why in the context of Oracle JET, we need to look at including an external library in our toolkit to help to solve this problem. In the JavaScript ecosystem, a number of modularity solutions are available. At the time that JET was being developed, RequireJS was the most popular and most stable solution in this area. In the meantime, a number of other modularity solutions have been developed, including Browserify and System.js, as well as the native module system that is part of ECMAScript 6. For JET, the decision has explicitly been made to not necessarily choose the newest solution as part of JET. Instead, the approach is to prefer the stability of a technology over its newness. In that light, RequireJS fits the bill perfectly. It has been around for quite some time. It does exactly what it needs to do for the purposes of JET, and when one of the other solutions becomes more stable and more applicable to JET, we'll be able to replace RequireJS with something different. That's the way we have built up JET, benefiting from the modular architecture that enables individual libraries and technologies to be replaced as needed. Let's now look specifically at RequireJS. You will see that we are able to delegate the loading of files to RequireJS. RequireJS also lets you build applications using modules, specifically using a module format called Asynchronous Module Definition, known as AMD. Every Oracle JET application is structured in the same way. You do all your work in the source folder. Inside the source folder, you'll find the index.html file. Right at the end of the index file, you will see a reference to RequireJS. So this is where RequireJS is loaded into the application. And you will also see a reference to main.js. Main.js is the entry point into the application. What it provides most importantly of all is what is called a require block. A require block is a RequireJS construct that provides the entry point into the application. If you're from a Java background, you will be familiar with the public static void main constructor in a Java desktop application. This is the equivalent of that. You see here a require block, and you see a number of modules being referenced here. These are modules and components that are inside of the Oracle JET application that are being loaded at startup of the application. In addition to one single require block, you will find in the View Models folder a define block for each of the modules in the application. You can see that by default, there are four modules in the application, each beginning with a define statement. Every Oracle JET application has multiple define blocks, in other words, multiple different modules, and one single require block. One single require block always found within the main.js file, which is always loaded by means of the index file. Via the lazy loading strategy that RequireJS provides, only the modules that you specify in a define block are loaded by that specific module. You have now learned the basics of RequireJS. RequireJS helps you by letting you delegate file loading while also letting you construct modular applications. In the next part, you will learn some more advanced RequireJS techniques. In particular, you will learn how to set up and work with configuration files in RequireJS, which will allow you to lazy load JavaScript resources when working with Oracle JET applications. In the homework for this part, spend some time going over the requirejs.org website.